Podcast.ph can be downloaded for free on iTunes by typing Podcast.ph programs. You can also listen on Podomatic, Spreaker, Stitcher, Clamor, YouTube, and our official URL, Podcast.ph. Like and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Google+. Podcast.ph, the most active and fastest-growing podcast network in the Philippines.
Can you adjust the frequency and volume a bit?
Startups, originators, música, cultura, the arts, política, sports, news, technology, crime, tragedy, comedy, lahat ng makabuluhan.
We are your independent podcast content creator, straight from the Philippine Islands. Mabuhay.
You're listening to Podcast.ph.
Welcome to the 52nd episode of Martin's Man Cave here on Podcast.ph. My name is Martin Andanar. Our guest today is a very interesting person, and you will not hear his name on the radios or maybe read his name on our front covers of our papers or mainstream television, but I did invite this person because I feel that we have a lot to learn from him, from his experience as a student here in Manila and his journey in the United States of America and leaving a successful business that his father set up here in Manila to pursue his dreams outside of the country, and also helping other minorities, especially in the Philippines, from where he was working in the United States. Rey T was born on December 11, 1957. In Binondo, Manila. His parents are T. Angpo and Nanita Rakaza T. He finished grade school and high school at Xavier School. He has three siblings. Then he was educated. He took up his PhD, graduated at the Northern Illinois University, specializing in education. He took up two masters, finished them all. At the UC Berkeley, he did Asian studies there, and at the NIU, or Northern Illinois University, he finished political science. He served at the training center, or international training office, at the NIU for quite some time. He's been away for almost 20 years, and by the way, he finishes university at the University of the Philippines, Bachelor of Science in Foreign Service, and after 1 year, he left for Paris to learn to speak French. Now he's back in the Philippines, and you can see his works, his journals at SlideShare about helping other people, helping the youth sector, the Muslim youth sector in the Philippines. And well, he's here in the studio right now. Thank you so much for accepting my invite, Rey.
Thanks so much, Martin, for inviting me here.
Very interesting. You grew up in Manila in a well-to-do family, can send you to just about any school you want to go to. Left a very flourishing business to pursue your dream, you know, your dream of studying abroad, and your dream of teaching and helping other people. That's a big sacrifice.
Yeah, right. I come from a family of business people. My father was from China. He already had a jewelry business there. And he came over to the Philippines when there was a change of government in China after the war, Second World War, and the Civil War in China. And but as a minority, I'm a double minority, I should say. One, I'm a mestizo Chinese Filipino, Chinoy. And my mother's from Leyte. We don't speak the dominant language, Tagalog. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And my father does not speak the Fujian language. Uh-huh. He speaks Fucho. So we are minority among the Chinese Filipinos, and mm-hmm. my kind of minority as Filipino too. So I see the side of people who are not from the dominant group, myself, from both ends. And I'd like to empower people who are minorities, mm-hmm, for instance, mm-hmm. And started doing that when we were in school. But I think we had very good teachers who were Jesuit priests who inculcated in us the virtue of doing service to others. Mm-hmm. And I think our motto was, we're empowered, but to do justice to help other people.
Yes. A great sacrifice for somebody who lived a very comfortable life here in the Philippines to follow that dream, to equip oneself so that it's easier for him to be able to help the minorities. But you could have stayed here in the Philippines. You could have joined an NGO in the Philippines, but you chose the more difficult path. You had to go somewhere outside of the country. Was this all planned, or it just fell into place?
Well, it's a little bit of both. While I was in the Philippines, I had a contract, so to speak, with my father. I wanted to go to Ateneo since I was with Savior School Jesuit forever. I paid the down payment to go to Ateneo, but my father wanted me to go to UP. I resisted it, but I felt, you know, deep down, I have to follow my father's advice. So even if I have the down payment, which was not refundable, Ateneo, I decided to follow my father's advice to go to UP, and I don't regret it because I have a totally different perspective now in my life. I can see from the Jesuit point of view and from the very secular point of view from UP. And from there, I moved on to be who I am. More service to the people was inculcated in me when I went to UP. Mm-hmm. And when I went abroad, since the contract with my father not to be engaged in politics, not to be an activist, mm-hmm. at UP, I was 4 years watching people go out in the streets from the halls of Palma Hall, looking down. But he didn't say I couldn't do any activism after undergraduate. So when I was in France, I was a volunteer. Every Friday, I was the Amnesty International International Secretariat for the French-speaking section in the world. So I would do research. They would say, what can you do? I said, I can do research, whatever you want. And they would say, okay, give us a political spectrum in this country for this week. Like, you know, it was then called Burma, now Myanmar. And then of Thailand, and then of the Philippines. So I'll tell them, this is how it's like in the Philippines. And this is the political situation. So I brief them every Friday. And then when there are people passing by who are English speakers from all over the world, they ask me to be a volunteer translator. I do interpreting on the spot for them. And from there, other NGOs in France, the Comité Catholique contre la faim pour le développement, and then the National Research Institute of Paris, and Terre des Hommes, Frères des Hommes, all NGOs asked me to volunteer doing interpreting. So many people went to France from the Philippines, Dr. Sylvia de la Paz, then with the Medical Action Group, Dr. Michael Tan, who's now the Chancellor of UP, Diliman. He was active with the Health Action Network, and many other people, Elizabeth Marcelino, who won the alternative to the Nobel Prize, I think in Norway, a psychologist. So I traveled all over France and interpreted their speeches from English to French, and Q&A back and forth, French-English. So I was already active when, politically speaking, doing NGO work when I was in France. And then when I went to the U.S., I was also involved in Amnesty International. I was asked to do, since I'm Asian, the regional coordinator for Asia. Mm-hmm. So we mobilized people, had activities from Berkeley, and then we linked up with people from San Francisco for some campaign work that we had, writing letters to senators in the U.S., to representatives, to the U.S. president, and then we got response, and then more letter-writing campaign. And when I came back to the Philippines, I was involved in a lot of human rights NGOs, volunteer work. That was much later, not in my youth, but when I was kind of like middle age or sort.
So coming from France, before you left for the United States, you came home first to the Philippines.
France, U.S., France, Philippines. And then back to the U.S. Uh-huh. in Northern Illinois University.
You followed this dream of studying, of furthering your your knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Hindi ba umalma yung father mo during that time? Because he was running a jewelry shop and...
Yeah, I think he was following the Confucian ethics, which will be, you know, there are different groups of people in China from the Confucian point of view. You have business, which is, in fact, merchant class. It's second to the educated class. Mm. That's the Confucian scholar is the higher level. And he said, well, maybe, Ray, you're more endowed in your mental capacity, so maybe you should do it. Your older brother, based on the Confucian ethic, will have to follow the father's business. So he kind of... already compartmentalized us from the Confucian point of view. And initially, I wanted to go to business really so bad. Mm-hmm. I wanted to do MBA, to business, go to the business school. My father said, no, that's not for you. And then I said, why not? I've been helping in the business when I was growing up, you know, weekends, nighttime, after school. You know, just like a little boy messing around with the gold and the diamonds when the customers come in, talking with them. And most of the customers were, of course, Chinese and many Indians, too, and also Filipinos. And, yeah, I wanted to do business, but at the same time, I'm glad I did the other route. Instead of going to business, I was doing the social good, the common good part
mm-hmm.
of it.
Mm-hmm. Your brother was the one who took over the business.
Exactly. My eldest brother took over the business when he was still in school. He would be my father's right-hand man when there's no school or Saturdays when the business and the okay. shop is open. And then when he graduated from college, he also worked full-time with my father. But I would be helping out just, you know, as a volunteer, but uh-huh. not... I really deep into the business.
Is it still running, the business now?
Since my brother passed away, his wife continued the business. Yes, it's still in Binondo.
The same name? The same name of the store?
Initially, it was my father's name, Angpo Goldsmith. Hmm. And then it was changed to my brother's name, Wins Jewelry.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but people knew he, you know, Chinatown is a small community. People know everyone. Uh-huh. And they know that Winnie is the son of the Angpo.
Yeah. And you essentially know the people there. You go to Chinatown, you can basically visit friends.
Right, yeah.
Family.
Even when I eat in a restaurant, you know, I'll just chit-chat with people. So what's a good dish? Okay, this is, what's your last name? What's your father's name? Oh, him. And they'll give me a whole story. Yeah. So people really know everyone in Chinatown.
You grew up in Chinatown.
I was born and raised in Chinatown in Binondo.
Your friends are still there?
Yeah, and then when I came back from the U.S., first reunion, guess where we had it?
In
Binondo. So we went to Escolta for first reunion, and then there's new Chinatown, Green Hills, another reunion there. And then another reunion in Banawe, another new Chinatown area.
What's your favorite restaurant in Manila, Chinatown?
I don't want to give a name or restaurant. No, they'll be endorsing one.
Yeah. You might hurt your friends.
No, right, yeah. No, and my friends own restaurants too, a few of my friends.
No, just one. Or maybe mention all of them.
No, I beg of you not to let me. Many friends own restaurants.
But
so
is your favorite restaurant their Chinese restaurant?
Yeah, sure.
Parang sabi mo, Jollibee. So, very interesting, this Chinatown in Manila. I think it's one of the oldest Chinatowns.
It is the first Chinatown in the whole world. But it was by accident that it became a Chinatown. You know that the Spanish wanted to cordon off the Chinese, mm-hmm. to control the Chinese, because the Spanish considered the Chinese as a threat.
Uh-huh.
It's a big ethnic group. And there was, in fact, a rebellion mm-hmm. in the historical days. Yeah.
How was it growing in Chinatown, being raised by a merchant, a businessman? Tell us a story about your father.
Okay. Yeah, my father came to the Philippines. He was a first-generation boat person. It was not yet called boat person. It was much later when the Vietnamese came in droves. They were called boat persons. But at my father's time, that was at the end of, way after the end of the Second World War and the Civil War in China. And he rode on a boat wrapped around his waist were a few gold bars. He hid them, you know, in cloth because his family was already jewelers in China. So he wanted to move out and reestablish himself, have a new business wherever he lands. So the boat landed in the Philippines. And growing up, my father would thank people who helped him in his transition to the Philippines. They're mostly Chinese and some Filipinos. So we will go to their places, and my father would say, this man helped me when I was coming here, when I left China and coming over. This person supported me. So I know more or less so many people. There was a network of people helping each other, and some of them had kids who were my classmates in school. So I'm now in contact with them still. I know that we have debt of gratitude to people who helped us. So when I grew up in China, many had the same story. And there are different generations of Chinese in Chinatown, and you would know by their names. Mm. People who have names like Kwatiko or Kohuanko or all of those three-letter words form into one word. There's the people who came much earlier during the Spanish time. But the people who kept their last name as Juan and wrote it the last name and the first letter, that will be the people who came later. Mm-hmm. That was my father's time.
And your father came here during the...
This was like around 1950-something.
The height of communism.
Right, when China became... under the control of the Communist Party of China.
He didn't want anything to do with that.
Right, yeah. So, he had business, he had big business. What would happen if he stayed on? Yeah, so he didn't want to have anything to do with that.
So, I'm just surmising, your father must have been one of those who also left the family there in China? Or
His brother, he had like nine brothers or so. Marami sila. And one came over, and I had uncles all over China. And when I went to when China opened up, like late 1970s, my father told me, not my older brother, but me, to go to China and see our family. So I went and met, we had family in Shanghai, and an aunt. She studied Columbia University, and she spoke with me. She refused to speak in Chinese. She just spoke in English. She wanted to show that she was Western educated, and she was very good. Uh-huh. And then I have a cousin, in Chinese we say brother, but we're cousins, in Wuhan. And then, of course, in Fuzhou, Xiamen, all over China.
Nice.
And they were surprised that I could speak Chinese because I was from the Philippines. It was the first contact with someone from outside of China at that time. Mm. It was like 1979 when China opened up.
So you speak Tagalog, Filipino, French, Chinese. What else do you speak?
well, Mandarin and the Fujian language, the Hokkien, as we call it. Yeah. Uh-huh. And I learned Bahasa Indonesia at NIU.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
A little bit, a teeny-weeny bit of Indonesian.
That's timely, since we're heading towards the ASEAN community. There's going to be an integration. So your father ran this business successfully here in China?
Yeah.
And how about your mother? Your mother is Chinese too? Or?
My mother's Filipina, and she was a student at the University of the East when my father and my mother met. And then they got married, and we stayed in Binondo. Uh-huh. And since we were born and raised in Chinatown, my mom had to learn Chinese, so she learned it. And spoke with everyone in Chinese.
From the Visayas to
from Leyte to Manila, and she just spoke Chinese just like that.
My goodness, you call that love?
yeah, exactly.
Among the three siblings, who are you closest to?
I'm close to all of them.
Okay. Very safe.
Yeah, they all have different traits.
Now, usually you're closest to the one who followed you immediately or the one you followed. Diba? Usually ganun yan eh, pag may mga gaps.
Okay, let me put it this way. I was the least, my perception, loved by my parents because I'm in the middle.
Oh, middle child.
Yeah, so nobody sees you. You're nowhere. Oh. Okay, my eldest brother, we roomed together when we stayed in Damar Village, when we stayed there. That's a new Chinatown, Quezon City and Banawe. Uh-huh. So I was close to him growing up since we were in the same room, went to the same school. And then my youngest brother was spoiled by my mom. My oldest brother was spoiled by my dad. And then I was no one. And then my youngest sister, when she came, like 10 years difference, mm-hmm. she was the favorite of everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And all of them are here in Manila.
Yeah. My eldest brother passed away like 5 years ago.
You were telling me earlier that your father passed on when you were in Berkeley, your mother passed on when you were in NIU, and your brother passed on, you weren't here too.
Right.
Wow. I mean, you've been like out of the country, no?
Yeah.
For a long time,
yeah. So when I was at Berkeley, my father passed away, and I had to come back right before he passed away. So he was at a heart center, and the doctor said he's in a coma. But right now, and it's true, I sense it, they say that even if people are in coma, talk to them, they can hear you, they may not be able to respond. I saw my father looking at me straight in the eye, and he had tears. So he was not like cabbage. He knew what was going on. His mind was active. So luckily, I talked to him. I did the Confucian thing, you know, knelt on my knees and kowtowed to him, the Chinese way, the Confucian way. Mm-hmm. And when my mother passed away, I just came back from the U.S. for Christmas vacation, and then she passed away right after I left. I think she had a stroke, and then I had to fly right back here to the Philippines. And then when my brother passed away, it was coming. He had cancer. So people said he had the late stage incurable cancer of his spine, and I did a videotape to say goodbye to him, mm-hmm. and it was hard. It was hard.
You have this extensive experience in teaching and guiding students or minority students from the South in Mindanao. And I mean, I was one of those who received that education, recipient of scholarship from the Department of State or State Department of the United States, and I had a lot of Muslim classmates with us during that time. And what are the learnings that you have gotten from teaching, from guiding all these different minorities from the Philippines, from the world over?
First off, just like most Filipinos who belong to the dominant culture, you know, the Tagalog-speaking culture or Cebuano-speaking culture, I grew up with a stereotype, which I heard growing up about the Muslims, all the negative stereotypes that you can think of. So I was very happy and lucky that I have met a lot of Muslims and indigenous people at my work at Northern Illinois University. But before I went there, I also taught at UP, Diliman. And when I learned that some of my students are indigenous or Muslim, I talked to them privately and said, I want you to speak up. We want to hear your point of view. Because all the time we only hear the dominant Christian point of view. And I would say, you know, this is for the sake of transparency. I was born and raised Christian, but I want to hear your voice. And in courses where I teach, for instance, the social science too, which is Western political thought, basically, you have St. Augustine, you have St. Thomas Aquinas, and everyone else is more or less Christian. Mm-hmm. So I say, okay, now that we've heard the Christian point of view, may I ask some of our Muslim friends here to speak up and give us your point of view? One thing is for us to learn also from the other side. Mm-hmm. So there's mutual understanding and interfaith dialogue. So at So after leaving UP, I went to the U.S. I learned so much that, you know, we are all human beings. We have differences in our faith, but even within a religion, for instance, Christianity, there's conservative Christian, there's liberal Christian, there's radical Christian. The same thing with Islam. They're conservative Muslim, they're liberal Muslim, and they are radical Muslims. So I was happy to learn that, you know, in Mindanao, the people who are being sent to the U.S. will be our future leaders. So I've in my 10 years of working with the group, I'm happy to confirm that many of them still continue doing volunteer community work. So many people have stereotypes. We have workshops telling people, okay, if you're Christian, stay on this line. If you are Muslim, stay on that line. And if you're indigenous, stay on this line. Now, let us hear what your stereotype of each other are. So tell us your stereotypes. And then let's listen to the people who are being stereotyped. And do you want to debunk these stereotypes? So we hear all sides. Maybe the most dramatic one I hear is everyone think everyone else is dirty. Because our sense of cleanliness is also cultural. So Christians say Muslims are dirty and Muslims say Christians are dirty because their practices are different. One stark difference would be, for instance, in the dorm, people say, why do Muslims wash themselves this way? But Muslims say, why do the Christians wash themselves that way? So they tell each other, well, because we're told to do it this way. Well, because before we pray, it's in the holy book, this is how we should wash ourselves. So from there, we learn that these are just misunderstanding, among other things. This is just one. But then we would learn that why are Muslims always in the news when they are violent acts? Why don't we say anything about Christians when they're violent acts? We always say, for instance, Muslim terrorists, but we don't say Christian terrorists. We just say, you know, people kill when they're Christian. Why don't we say Christian terrorists? It's not parallel, and the image being given is not standardized. So there's hurt feeling, angry feeling from Muslims and indigenous people when we talk about them in the Philippine context, since they are the minorities here.
Have we moved further forward? Have we improved in that relationship? You've been gone, you've been working for 10 years with the minorities, and now you're back in the Philippines. Do you see any difference?
Wow. Yes and no. No, because I believe that the dominant group is still very anti-Muslim. If you look at the media, just a cursory view of the mainstream newspaper, you would see a lot of opposition, for instance, to any talk of autonomy in Muslim Mindanao. But you have the enlightened bishops, for example, taking the lead and saying, well, it's about time that we see the injustice done to the Muslims, and we should rectify the errors through the centuries to recognize the rights of Muslim Filipinos and indigenous Filipinos. So on the one hand, there's still a lot of anger, hatred, discrimination, racism against Muslims. And I learned from our students who went to Northern Illinois University that some would be offered jobs. This would be adults and youth, high school students who were offered jobs at McDonald's and Jollibee and Chow King, all of these. And then they asked them, what is your name? Mohammed. Oh, we don't have opening. Just like that, right after offering them a job. So this is very shocking for me. Like, what has his name got to do with the job already offered to him now being not available to him? This is a real case. And then we had an adult participant who's also Muslim, who was offered a job to work in a government office. And when he gave his name, they said, we'll call you. Then they did not call him, so he asked... they said, you know, he has a very, very good credentials. They wanted him. And he said, oh, the position's not available anymore. So there's still a lot of discrimination against Muslims. But we have moved away from that in the sense that there are some leaders who are enlightened. Mm-hmm. who want to rectify historical errors and continue the dialogue. But my problem is many of the interfaith dialogue are very shallow. It's like, okay, you give your spiel, Christian. You give your spiel, you're Muslim. You indigenous give your spiel, and goodbye. There's no real dialogue for hard questions which should be asked. And people just don't want to hurt the sensitivities of other people.
That's spot on, Ray. You know, the NIU class of 2008, the CCP NSD, which I was part of, and you were one of our professors, that really inspired me to spearhead this project to set up the first Muslim TV network in the Philippines. And when I was presenting it in one of the marketing presentations, so I said, oh, this is the demography, this is how it is, 40% male, 60% female, and then you'd have almost 5 million Muslims around the Philippines, 80% are below poverty, 20% are just in the middle class sector. And then the marketing person said, exactly, we shouldn't set up a TV station because 80% are poor. I said, but that's just the same as the Philippines.
Yeah, right.
The entire Philippines is 80% poor.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And they were saying, di ba parang grabe yung discrimination? I got hurt.
Yeah.
I got hurt because, because I'm, first of all, I was spearheading it. Number two, she would say that. And number three, well, my father is a Balik Muslim. No? So medyo... Tama ka dun sa discrimination. Hindi pa rin natapos hanggang ngayon, no? But you come to think of it, you go to Mindanao, kung anong kahirapan doon, nakikita mo sa paligid mo, that essentially is a microcosm of the entire nation.
Yeah.
Diba? Yeah. So malungkot talaga, no? What is Peace Direct?
Yeah, Peace Direct is a London-based non-governmental organization, not-for-profit. Mm-hmm. And it covers conflict situations all over the world.
Uh-huh.
And it gives funding for NGOs, small amount, maybe $5,000 on an annual basis. NGOs have to compete. And they look for countries where the conflict is intense. And they will launch a Philippine web page in their website, which is... insight on conflict this month, late this month, featuring the different profiles of peace organizations working on conflict transformation.
And you're the representative of Peace Direct London here in Manila.
That's correct. I am their Philippine correspondent. So I've written about the Bansamoro basic law, the reaction of the people and what's going on. And then I've submitted profiles and continuing to submit profiles. If anyone has profiles of peace organizations, please contact me. We want to feature your organization. One good thing is you'll have high profile globally if your NGO will be featured. It has to be non-governmental. And secondly, you will have network of other peace organizations around the world, including in the Philippines, so you can have relations with them. And number three, you can compete for funding under Peace Direct's grants that they give out every year.
So this is a great way to step up and become part of a larger organization so you can widen your reach if you have any advocacy, especially in conflict areas like Mindanao. No. Ray is the representative in the Philippines. You can just call him up. And do you have any Facebook? Of course, you have a Facebook page. And of course, you have a LinkedIn. You have a slide share where I always follow you. But for the sake of those who would want to follow you, Ray, where do they
go? Yeah, you can go to Peace Direct's website or specifically Insight on Conflict. And you can find me, Ray T. And you can email me from there if you want to.
Okay. Professor Rey, what is your ultimate goal as a professional, as an educator, as a doctor, as one of the leading advocates of peace here in the country. You're back after 20 years. What are your plans? You can answer that after we play the song. This song is for you and for the entire country, no? We are with Professor Rey T in Martin's Man Cave. My name is Martin Andanar. We are still with Professor Rey T, who just came back from Illinois, where he was teaching at the Northern Illinois University and also one of the coordinators of the international office there at the university. And I was, I'm actually privileged to be one of those students who went under the tutelage of Professor Rey back in 2008. There are about 36 of us sent there from the Philippines, from different islands, Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao. We were sent to Northern Illinois University by the State Department of the U.S. to learn how the Americans, how they strengthen their community and how they encourage citizen participation, most especially. And we went around the United States, one of the most unforgettable programs that I have attended. We went to Chicago, we went to St. Louis, Ray's back after 10 years of teaching there and studying at the same time. He's one of those Filipinos who've been around the world, you know, knows a lot of languages, can speak, but his heart still remains the Philippines. His heart is still here, and he still wants to continue helping, especially the minorities here in the Philippines. Marami dyan sa mga Muslim. The question earlier, Rey, was, what is your dream? When will this end, this journey of yours? I mean, you're traveling from one place to the next. You're back here, and I feel that you're going to be here temporarily because you're going to move to another country again and help other people there, etc. What is your goal?
Yeah, well, initially when I was teaching at the University of the Philippines, my goal was to change the world. Uh-huh. I wanted, to turn the world upside down. But one time, when I saw my student who had graduated, he worked at the Bureau of Customs, he told me, "Hi, Professor, lahat ng tinuro mo, wala na." I said, "What do you mean?" "Sir, diba you taught us justice in the social science course?" "Yeah." "Sir, mayaman na ako, mayroon akong bahay, tsaka may kotse. So, tatapon ko na yung lahat ng tinuro niyo sa akin." So, I was shocked to hear this. So, I had, internal soul searching. What did I do wrong? Mm-hmm. Then I realized, no, maybe I couldn't change everyone. People have their own minds. If I can change only one person, that's a success story of one person. So I shouldn't try to set my standard to such a degree that I want everyone to be like me. No way will that happen. So my dream now is to work for peace, but there are many elements of peace. If we want peace, we have to work for justice, which will be working for equality and equity, and for human rights, recognizing the rights of everyone, whatever your station in life is, and male or female. And with the help of many of my friends from El Salvador, from the U.S., from the Philippines, people say, "But where's the woman?" So right now, I'm very conscious when I do anything and say anything, I always say, "Where is the woman?" Like, if you're involved in non-governmental organization, are they all men? Do you have women participating in it? Mm-hmm. And you have a group of leaders, are there women in the leadership role? And when you talk of serving the community, do women benefit? Do we measure the success story in terms of women's participation and women benefiting from the projects? So right now, I learned to add a woman's perspective and agenda in everything I do. And as time goes on, because of climate change and with super typhoons that we never had, we cannot separate the environment from working for peace. If we destroy the environment, we will destroy human lives and there will be no future for all of us. Mm-hmm. So my direction would be, you know, everything comes in small bites, but we have to work at these little things to attain the big picture of peace, of women, gender inclusion, environmentalism, working for minority rights and empowering the marginalized, underprivileged people, the minorities.
There's so many students who listen to this program, and a lot of them would want to break free from poverty. They just want to go out there and learn something new and connect with people like you and me, be in a program like the one that I got myself into, the NIU. And you've also managed and you've also taught a lot of the students like the ones I mentioned. And what is your advice for those who are listening? Now, for some reason, wala na, it's like hopeless, helpless. Anong gagawin ko? Paano pupunta doon? Anong advice mo doon sa mga estudyante na feeling nila wala na silang pag-asa pero gusto pa rin nilang mangarap?
Well, you know, life is a compromise. On the one hand, I'm sure your parents want you to do something, be something. On the other hand, you also want to do something and be something. If you can strike a balance, that will be good. But always follow your happiness. At the end of the day, you will live your life. So if you do something which is totally against your will, who will suffer? It's going to be you. Maybe you should talk it over with your parents, talk it over with your family members, and then find out who you really are. Follow your passion, follow your dream, but try not to step on the toes of other people. You can, of course, we all want to have a good life. Of course, we want to earn money. That's a requirement for us to live in this society. Mm-hmm. We need to have money. That's a way to survive. You have to pay bills. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, let's not forget other people. Serving other people. Yeah. Those who were given scholarships to go abroad are the ones who do not only excel in academics, some don't even excel in academics, mm-hmm. but who have done a lot of good, did volunteer service, joined a lot of organizations, and doing outreach work. Mm-hmm. Those are qualities which are important. Like, on the one hand, you might want to spend 9 to 5 working fine to earn a living. But maybe on your free time, do some service. Reach out to other people. And even in your workplace, if you find a job, try to make sure that people who are minorities, like the stories I've given earlier, will not be deprived of jobs just because they have a name, Mohammed.
You can check out Ray's work journals here on SlideShare or LinkedIn. He's written a lot. I mean, the U.S. Electoral College for Beginners, International Human Rights, Law for Beginners, Civil Society, Social Movement, and the State. My goodness, this is just from wall to wall. Writing Literature Review, Philosophy and Charts, quotes, philosophical quotes, subcultures, different economic systems. And dami nito, no? They can go to your LinkedIn, right? Rey T LinkedIn?
Right.
Or what's the best place, a SlideShare or LinkedIn?
SlideShare will have everything in there. Mm-hmm. LinkedIn will be the latest ones, mm-hmm. which will be updated.
And if you do have projects, if you come from a conflict community, go and check out the website of Peace Direct. Look for Rey T, who will hook you up with the right people, tell you what to do, how to apply for the funds. No? Tama,
right?
Tama,
yeah.
No? Tama, no? Okay, and thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for inviting me. My pleasure to be here.
I'd like to dedicate just one episode next time. Just about Binondo. Maybe you can take me around there. I can bring my audio recorder, and we can just...
Yeah, that would be wonderful.
You're going to give me a tour. Ikaw pala yung guru dyan sa Binondo. You're the go-to guy. Thank you so much, Professor Rey T. Good luck in your endeavors and to the university that you will be joining somewhere there. Hindi ko na mapakita, baka maudlot.
All right. Thank you, Martin, for inviting me.
And for the students of NIU and those who received the scholarship from the State Department of the United States, you know, if you know Rey T, you know where to contact him. Just go to his Facebook page or Twitter or Instagram. Do you have an Instagram?
I do.
Yeah, great. You're all over too. This is the program Martin's Man Cave. My name is Martin Andanar. Thank you so much.
This podcast.ph presentation is supported by Martin Andanar's Homecast Studio and audio.ph.